The head of Italy's civil protection agency says there are no reports so far of any deaths. A number of buildings have collapsed and local authorities are still assessing the full extent of the damage. Daniel Bircher, BBC News.
Well, let's get an eyewitness account now. I'm joined by Janet Fuller-Love. Janet is a British national who lives in the village of Colmorano. Not far then from the epicentre of this earthquake. Janet, how are you?
Feeling rather shaken, to be honest with you. It takes a long time for your, well, your nerves just get basically very shredded by this kind of thing.
I bet. Can you describe, if you can, what it was like going through this earthquake? We're hearing that people felt it in Rome. It was very powerful.
It was incredibly powerful. We were probably about 20 to 30 kilometres from the epicentre. And my husband and I'd woken up earlier and gone back to bed and woke instantly. The whole place started shaking. We were sleeping in the back part of the house, which is safer because it's a new build. The old part of our house, which is like many here, stone and brick, built on clay, really shook. We could hear things coming down. We dashed out barefoot, listening to buildings crashing in the distance. We could hear them. We could hear sounds of buildings crashing around us and just watching our entire house shake. It's petrifying. It's terrifying. I can't begin to describe. I'm not scared much, but this really terrifies me. There's nothing you can do. Nothing.
I suppose we can be thankful that there's no reports of any deaths so far, because people are on such high alert in the region that you're in, and you're always told, aren't you, to get outside, get away from the buildings.
Well, either that, or you have to stand under a lintel or in a strong position in the house. I mean, the reason that we've all been on high alert, and in fact, indeed, last night I went and spoke to the local mayor in our village to warn her. We watch an earthquake forecast site on YouTube by Dutchsinse, and this guy's spot on, and he had it. He said there was going to be something like this. He was absolutely spot on. So he probably saved people's lives, you know.
It was great to talk to you. We're glad that you're safe. We wish you all the best as well. Do keep in touch with us. Let us know how you get on. Thank you very much, Fiona.
All right, guys. So there's one shout out, but there's more. Okay, there's more. So let's go see. There's another one that's let's see. Where is it? Is this it? This might be it. Hold on. I gotta find it live. Okay. I guess this is it.
Okay, let's speak to Janet Fuller-Love. She's a British national who lives in the village of Colmorano, not far from the epicenter of the latest earthquake. Janet, I just want to say thank you for joining us. I understand that the aftershocks continue.
Yeah, there was one just a few seconds ago, and I just sort of explained that I might have to run if it's big.
Okay, we appreciate that. We'll speak to you whilst we've got you then. When the quake hit, did you know what to do?
Yes, because I mean, I've been in the last, well, we've been lived here a while and we're used to earthquakes, but I have to say I've never been in anything like that one. But we actually we've been living downstairs in a workshop area, so we had quick access out because we were forewarned. We watch a Dutchsinse, a YouTube channel forecast who's very accurate, and we knew it was coming. We knew it was coming.
So where did you go to? I mean, where have the residents gone to?
We're still living in our house, sort of, in the workshop, but we ran outside and just basically watched our house shaking and listened to buildings. We could hear buildings falling down around us, which is pretty scary.
And how are your neighbours and residents of Colmorano?
Everybody has this fear, paura, they call it. But we say, don't be scared, be prepared. It's hard not to be scared. That's the motto of our forecaster, Dutchsinse, who, because of him, a lot of the people in the village knew this was coming. We went and talked to the mayor last night, forewarned. People knew they go and sleep in cars, or sleep where they can get out of the house quickly or easily, or you stand under a beam or a door. You avoid staircases and things like that.
So what are you going to be doing tonight then, as you settle down for the night?
Hoping there's not another one. We've been so busy shoring up the front of our house today. We parked our digger up against it to try and keep the front wall attached to the house. It's that bad. And we've been so busy doing that, we haven't eaten. So in a minute, when I've finished with you, I'm going to go and have a steak and a beer and celebrate that I'm still alive.
Salute. you obviously know what you're doing, but have you seen evidence of emergency workers in your village and in the surrounding area that's been affected by this quake?
Oh, very definitely. I mean, the civil protection are incredible. After a quake, they quite often prevent people going back in their homes. They, you know, there's a huge gymnasium in our village. There are a lot of people sleeping there. There are something like 35, 40 families who are homeless. They're not allowed to return to their homes because they're too dangerous. They send land engineers to check. They make sure that you understand what to do in a quake. You know, everybody has a kit. We've got stuff in our car, that water, medical supplies, change of clothes, because quite often you run outside, you get out of bed, you haven't got anything on necessarily. So, you know, you have to be prepared for it.
So apart from the preparedness, what's the mood like at the moment?
Everybody's still scared. And I was watching the forecast earlier, and Dutch says that there's a new wave coming in, so new wave of pressure coming in over the next 2-3 days, so we know we're not through with it yet. It does shred your nerves. It does shred your nerves, I have to say. I have never been so terrified. There's nothing you can do. Everything is out of your control. And being a control freak, I don't like that very much.
Well, Janet, if this is, you know, this situation is not ideal for you, and you know you're living in an earthquake zone, do you plan to stay there, or perhaps are you considering moving?
No, I'm going to stay. I mean, we have literally worked for 16 months on this house. We put everything into it. We've done it ourselves, not built it for us. New roof, new second floor. My heart's here. The country's beautiful. It's a kind of balance. One of the most beautiful places in the world, and yet also the most terrifying. When I look at those Apennine mountains this evening, it looks so calm and so beautiful. But my heart's here, I love it. I'm not going anywhere.
Janet, we appreciate that. Do stay safe. Our line was breaking up there. But have a lovely evening, and as I said, stay safe.
Thank you very much.
That's Janet Fuller Love.
Thank you, Janet. And again, I'm going to download this as well here. Let me grab that right now, just in case somebody wants to try and whack it. Okay. So, that being said, you know, if you are a denier, I understand. Or if you're a skeptic, I understand skepticism. But when skepticism becomes denial. By the way, Janet hand-knitted me gloves. And International shipped them to me for Christmas. She is incredibly nice, and so you don't have to take my word for it. When I issued the warning for Italy the day before, it was based upon the very deep earthquake that had happened down below in the Tyrrhenian Sea. You can go watch the video on my channel. I issued the warning. We said watch out for up to a 7.8 earthquake. There was a 5.8 down here where the bottom of the red arrow is, and it was very deep. It was 560 kilometers deep. And this led me to issue the warning for central Italy, northeast of Rome, right along the plate boundary, which goes right through the area where you see these four earthquakes right now. And when I issued the warning, I said, I don't take this lightly. This is going to be the largest earthquake in years. It's going to strike here, la, 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 la. And it was. It was the largest earthquake in years. And it struck right in the spot where we warned. Didn't just get it by chance. Didn't just get lucky. It's not just me waving a wand at a huge area. I named the area northeast of Rome along the plate boundary in central Italy to watch for the largest earthquake in years, and it hit the next day. And that's why they were outside warning. She went and talked to the mayor. They talked to the people in town. People got the warning. They got out, and they were able to prepare. That's just one example of many. I'm not bragging, I have to tell you, just because people deny. By the way, 5.0 just hit down here near Crete in Greece. See this, guys? 5.0. So, this fulfills the Crete forecast. We were looking for, well, again, this is one magnitude less than, but we took it down by a magnitude last night. And I told you guys a majority was going to be striking up near Romania, and that's within 72 hours. Well, this is 24 hours in, and a 5 just hit down at Crete at Greece, just north of Crete, actually. So, this is near the Ionia range, the mountain range that moved by 6 inches in a day. Okay, so just understand that's going on. If you are a skeptic, you need to at least wake up to the fact that I've put the arrows on the map. This was the biggest debate of all. Do earthquakes progress across regions? Yes, they do. Now you can see it on the map. What, I mean, do you think I'm just getting lucky with the arrows? I don't change the arrows. The arrows stay static. They've been on there for God knows how long now. So the arrows stay in the same spot. This is the way the earthquakes transfer. The pressure transfers around these regions. Most of these are plate boundaries. But the progression happens from our deep earthquakes and spreads out all the way around the planet. And you can calculate your magnitudes in between each zone, and you can get it down to a very fine point and down to a specific magnitude. The way you get your fine point and the way you get your magnitude is already defined in my How to Forecast an Earthquake video and post that's been out since 2014. It's just, look, my people will perish for lack of knowledge. It's ignorance that's the enemy here, guys. So while people are in denial, I urge them to go check out the different, really, you got so much learning to do, and I'm not here to school you. So you know what? This is YouTube. Like I said, YouTube debate is not for me. I've already graduated above and beyond that. I've been doing this for 7 years. I've already fought Mick West and Metabunk, the biggest skeptic site in the world, man. They have a whole freaking section on me. You want to go see stuff? Go over to Mick West, the creator of Tony Hawk Pro Skaters, and you can go see them talk about harp rings being birds and bugs and know that I'm LOLing at you, laughing out loud here at my computer while you sit there and try and mock me. I'm actually mocking you back for your lack of knowledge. And just know there is no way to shame me because I already got listed as a threat on the Department of Homeland Security website. Yes, that really happened. I also have a NASDAQ article that's been written about me due to the number of shutdowns and unjust things that have happened to me because I happened to make a stupid scientific discovery that nobody wanted to freaking believe. Now, come on, get real. So, all right, I'm having too much fun here. This is great. Word up to my people. I'll be done in a little while, I guess. I'll be back in a little while. This is obviously carrying on the movement that we're expecting is fanning out from the regions. And now, with our new round of deep earthquakes, as I told you last night, now that a new deep 5 has hit, this means the potential to go up to 7.0 again, up to 7, and it could be striking in the middle of our fulcrum point, our silent zone to the west. I mean, I don't see how a skeptic or anybody could deny this, okay? Look at our earthquakes here, our deep earthquakes, where our letter D is. And then look where our shallow 5.9 is, okay? And there's a halfway point in between these two zones. And the fulcrum point, as I call it, the halfway point in this silent zone where there are no earthquakes, should be the next spot to be hit. And the magnitude should be 1 to 2 magnitudes larger than the deep earthquake down below. So that means what, 6.1, 7.1? Up to 7.3, I think, is what I said earlier in my update. Yeah, that's what it is, 7.3. Because you have to add the 5.1 plus the 4.9 plus the 5.0. And if you add the 5.1 plus the 5.0, that's 5.2. And add in the 4.9, that's basically a 5.3. So a deep 5.3 cumulative total has happened right here today over the last 24 hours. And that means the area to the west is under serious pressure and the area to the south is under serious pressure and the area to the east is under pressure, but not as much. It's a greater distance that's being displaced. So, but the area to the south, same thing. Central point, the fulcrum point. And the fulcrum point here is obviously the plate boundary, so we have a red arrow that goes right over it. And it's a spot that fractured already. Broke, what, a month and a half ago with the big earthquake? By the way, the coast of New Zealand, the antipodal, the opposite side of the planet to the coast of New Zealand, believe it or not, guys, is central Italy, on the exact opposite side of the planet. What are the chances of that, right? Isn't that weird? And isn't it weird that both spots were hit within weeks of each other with the largest earthquakes in decades? Italy and the coast of New Zealand. And that they're antipodal to one another almost exactly. It's just wild. Oh, so anybody who's in, you know, I mean, I understand questioning. I understand raising doubt. I understand even freaking raising some concerns. But when you start immediately going down the whole Dutchsinse donations, Dutchsinse doing this for a name, Dutchsinse, blah, 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 you're already questioning my motives. Can we talk science first before you question my motives, or do you want to talk me personally? Because I've already done that with Professor John Vidali, and he failed miserably. Anytime somebody is resorting to ad hominem attacks, you know, attacks about this and that not related to earthquakes, then guess what that is? That's actually losing the debate. In my book, you've lost the debate. If you go outside of earthquakes on trying to debate me, you already lost before you even started. So, and that's what's happened with Big Solar. That's what's happened with all of them. They went outside. They tried to criticize my personality. Some of them even tried to criticize the way I look. Some even tried to criticize my unboxing videos. You know, like, I mean, just that's ad hominem. That has nothing to do with earthquakes. You can't pick apart anything that I'm showing you here. We don't just name vast areas across large distances. We name small areas for certain amounts of time for specific magnitudes. Which, by the way, the other guys don't. You'll notice the other forecasters on YouTube, and this is not being mean to anybody. I'm just calling it what it is. They put big red lines over whole areas and say, watch out here. They don't give a time. They don't give a magnitude. I mean, to me, that's not forecasting. That's just like the farmer's almanac, all right? But for me, I want people to be able to look for a specific period of time, usually 72 hours. But I do forecast for up to a week in specific instances. So the reason I do it for 72 hours and 3 to 4 days is I don't want people to have to look over their shoulder the whole week. And I certainly don't want a whole region with a big red line over it to have to worry. I want only a small, itty-bitty location to actually have to watch for a large earthquake, like our triangular bend here in between our two zones. Or here, south of Wellington. Okay, so I mean, it's a very small little area. I mean, it's super tiny. We're not putting a big red line over all of New Zealand. I'm telling the people in central New Zealand, south of Wellington, right where the red line goes across, out to sea, right out to sea to the east, south of Wellington. It's a tiny pinpoint of a prick of an area in the West Pacific. And we're only watching for a few days. Okay, so it's not even deniable. You'll see it get hit. The middle point will get hit, followed by the northern point. And the northern point will be the halfway point between the middle point and the movement to the north. I know that sounds confusing, but again, an earthquake's going to hit here first. Okay, let me describe it this way. Earthquake's going to hit here first. Then we're going to see another earthquake hit here. Halfway point between each zone. So first thing's going to get hit here. That'll halve the area, and then we go to the half of the half, which is our arrow. And those will be hit again, and it'll halve itself each time. It's amazing. It's amazing that it happens. That's a discovery. I mean, I don't know why people would want to deny it. You can see it happen on the screen in front of you. It's not just a chance. It's not just luck. But I really do start to get bothered by people who don't do the research and then automatically deny. And that's what we're going through right now, is people that just haven't done the research. They're operating under an assumption, a false assumption to begin with, that earthquakes can't be forecast. What gives them that assumption? Is it because it says it somewhere on a website? Is that the appeal to authority that they're using? Because the appeal to authority that's being used is a logical fallacy. Look, I've already debated the biggest names in the industry. I'm not going to do it with people on YouTube. I know you keep guys, they keep sending me little things, pop-ups here on the side. It's not going to happen. Look, I know you want attention. I know you're trying to grow your channel, but I've already been through this. You cannot deny that the earthquakes are following the arrows on the screen. I just showed you the last month's worth of earthquakes. Secondly, you cannot deny that the magnitudes that are striking are the magnitudes that are being named. If I do miss an area, I come back and correct myself. And there's usually a good scientific explanation behind each reason why there's an error or a forecast hit. So there's errors, there's hits, just like the weather. And just like the weather, we can see where the seismic storms are progressing, from low pressure areas to high pressure areas. From areas that there is high pressure, it's transferring into areas where there is no pressure. And when it transfers from an area where there's a lot of pressure into an area where there's little pressure, that's the silent zone, the area where there's little pressure, that builds immediately into a lot of pressure in the silent zone, and the middle point gets hit, the fulcrum, between the two zones that are moving. It's not up for debate. It's not even up for debate. You cannot debate me on it because it's happening. What can I say in response? It's happening. You'll say it's not. I say it is. I say here it is on the screen. You say no, it's not. I mean, what kind of debate is that? It's happening. You can see it. Thousands of people tune in every day to see this happen. And nobody was able to see this happen, by the way, until we put a 3D spinning globe live for the people to see on the world, for the general public to see. Because the USGS site sucks so hard, and all the earthquake reporting services are so gate-kept that they don't want you to see the foundations of modern-day geology, and all their declaratory dogmatic statements are wrong. Yeah, they called me a conspiracy theorist for saying fracking causes earthquakes. What more can I say? That's what I will throw back at you if you try to come at me. I'll be like, dude, like they already called me.